Welcome to Dateline Health. This is Fred Lippman coming to you from Nova Southeastern University. And you know, we had a show about a year ago or so about issues relating to the development of children, children as they are growing, as they are learning, as they become what you know as young adults. So I figured I'm going to bring back one of the star of stars, who is now returning to us for a fourth time. I checked the history, is Dr. Roni Cohen, Leiderman, who is the Dean and Associate Professor at the Mailman Segal Center for Human Development. Welcome, Roni.
Thank you so much.
Good to have you. And Dr. Lorraine Breffni, very nice name. She's an Irish Colleen, as we discussed before the show. And she's an executive director of early childhood at Mailman Segal Center for Human Development. Welcome. Well, good to have you here.
Nice to be here.
Well, I speak to Dr. Leiderman quite often, so I'm going to start with you.
Okay.
So tell me what, I know obviously you are an administrative person at the Mailman Segal Center, but tell me the tasks that face you on a daily basis.
Well, I have a very busy position. I am responsible for making sure that upwards of 1,000 children are safe, that they are healthy, and that they have the highest quality early care and education that we can provide at the Mailman Segal Center. I'm also involved in some outreach activities because our mission is to do early childhood, do it really well, but disseminate that into our community so that every child benefits, not just the children who come to our program.
Okay, and Dr. Leiderman, a lot of people were really amazed with all the years that we've had the Mailman Segal Center here at Nova Southeastern University. I was really rather surprised after the last show where you spoke with one of your colleagues about the extent of what the Mailman Segal Center does. So I'm going to ask you just to give us a little synopsis of what does the Mailman Segal Center at Nova Southeastern University do, and why is it here?
Well, I'll answer what we do and why we're here to start with. We are here to educate students and to, as Lorraine just mentioned, to disseminate the information that we know to undergraduate, graduate, postdoc, and so on, students, so that they can become the best they can in their career and their career paths as they move on. So we do that by offering numerous clinical and educational programs, and we do that through a number of institutes. So we have the Early Childhood Institute, and that has our preschool programs, early childhood programs, things like child study, community outreach, and parent support. And then we have our Autism Institute, where we have the Bodman School, which is in collaboration with Broward Public Schools for children with a diagnosis of autism. And in that program, we also have very young children. It's interesting because most children start their, and we'll talk about that today, I'm sure, start their journey with early childhood education at age 3. But we know how important it is to start way earlier than that. So even with children before the diagnosed, or early diagnosis, or even at risk for autism, we start programs very early for that particular population. And then we also have research institute, we have clinical programs, clinical institute, and that includes a feeding disorders program, an assessment program, a challenge and behavior program, and in collaboration with the NSU Dental School, we actually have a dental clinic for children with special needs.
You know, the most people don't know that at the Jim and Jim Moran Center, that most of the composite nature of what you just discussed are in various physical locations right here in Davie. A lot of the folks, when we spoke about it, because I remember talking about Mommy and Me program when you were here last, and how wonderful it was that your center and the people who work at your center, it's not yours, you don't own it, but the way you put your life into it, I feel like it's your center. The amazing intervention, and that intervention changes the child's entire life. So let's talk a bit about that.
It does. It changes the trajectory of future learning, experiences, social economic outcomes. Everything you mentioned so well said is so true. And it's actually parent-child, because you also have many fathers that come to our program. And the beauty of this is that it's open to the community, so there's no screening process before the child comes. But once they're in our program, because of the professionals that run our program, our team of faculty and staff, we pick up on early issues. And those are between 10 and 15% of most children do have some sort of a concern, whether it's physical, emotional, developmental disorders. So we pick that up rather early. We have something called child study, where we bring a child to a program where we have our psychologists, our speech and language therapists, our behavioral therapists, teachers, administrators, and we discuss the child, the whole child, involve the parent in the discussion, and make some decisions about next steps.
Dr. Breffni, one of the things I discussed with Dr. Leiderman on the last show, and actually the last couple of shows, is that the magnificence of the Mailman Segal Center and the many years of input that Dr. Mickey Segal put into the development of the center, simple things like play. How does that deal with the development of children? But the reason that we brought it up and started to talk about it is because we demand so much of our school systems, dominantly the public school systems, where we have teaching professionals that are in there trying to do the best they can. Mm-hmm. And yet we have children that come into their system without having the advantage of developmental review.
I think that taking a step back, you're sure. Right that we do need to do something about the state of education when children get into kindergarten and above. Just look at Broward County itself for a minute. The Florida Standard Assessment in English language and literature at third grade, only 57% of children in Broward County are satisfactory or above in reading at grade 3. And that means that 47% of children are falling behind. That's at third grade. And we know that if children fall behind at third grade, they very rarely catch up. So what's the single biggest variable that can make a difference in a child's life? And that is a teacher, and a teacher who cares, and a teacher who notices what the individual needs of particular children are. And yes, it's a complex issue to deal with when you're talking about maybe a classroom of 30 children, but it is something that teachers cannot neglect. They have to know to get to know their children, and they have to get to know that children have different learning styles, they have different needs, and that one size fits all approach doesn't work. So yes, we do need to revamp and rethink how we teach, particularly in the early years. And that's why in the Mailman Segal Center, we pay a particular attention to that. Our curriculum does acknowledge that children are capable, that they're curious. And yes, there are some children who have needs that we need to look a bit deeper and see how we can embrace and include those children and ensure their success in the early years, so that when they graduate and go to kindergarten, that they're off to a better start.
Let me give you an example. I discussed this a couple of times with Dr. Leiderman. I know, particularly in our society today, when we are so acutely aware of, and we're so sensitive relative to the security of children, that I think this might be a point in time when we need to think a little bit beyond just the physical security, which is a major issue in the United States, but yet we have to talk about the security of the child as a human species, putting them into a venue where people don't recognize that either they have an eye problem, a hearing problem, or a developmental issue. What do you think of that?
I think that I'll go back to what I said before. a good teacher will be able to capture those issues. And certainly at the Mailman Segal Center, we do hearing screenings, we do vision screenings. And if a child has a concern in any way, our teaching staff know that we have a process that they can follow, and that is our child study process. And that's where we meet and we think about, we reach a consensus on what are the needs of this particular child at this particular time. And we always involve parents in that process. The parents know their children best. But at the same time, a new parent may not recognize that their child isn't meeting those milestones like their peers. We do that in a very sensitive way, in a very strength-based way. And we bring in resources that we need to, that we have access to on the university campus. So we have that multidisciplinary team approach. And again, even in the community, even in the centers in some of our highest need communities, we bring resources from NSU to them. We do have nurses out in some of our programs. We do presentations to teachers in the community about how to identify the autism spectrum disorder in even very young children. What are some of the red flags? So our goal is to make sure that every child, their needs are met. And sometimes it is complex, and sometimes it takes time. And sometimes, a child is in that kind of gray area where it's more challenging to make a definitive assessment. But in those instances, we also have our Unicorn Children's Foundation Clinic, where we can do screening and assessment for a range of issues, and that is open to the community as well. In a sense, the way I'm describing it, it's almost like we are a one-stop shop for families, not just at the Mailman Segal Center, but in our community. And our goal is to support children's healthy development.
Dr. Leiderman, the issue really, the reason I'm trying to translate what we do here to the community at large, because don't forget, we see a very small number in population of the children that dominantly are within the South Florida region and predominantly in Broward and Palm Beach and North Dade. We are a beacon for the education world, because the Mailman Segal Center and its codicil of responsibilities, its whole spectrum of history, tells the rest of this nation, if not the world, there are things that we can do.
It's so well said, and that is part of our mission. One thing, because we are an academic center as well in terms of educating undergraduate, graduate students, even we know that parents typically always see a pediatrician. They may never get to your optometrist, optician, ophthalmologist. They may not get to a psychologist, but typically every child gets to their pediatrician at some point in those early weeks, months, and years. So we are now training postdoctoral interns in pediatric medicine to make sure that pediatricians are aware of the developmental issues at hand. We work in our community, and our outreach beyond the community, which is what we're talking about, which is so important, is actually going to be coming through what we're now calling the I3, the Innovative Instructional Institute, that is going to be right now, it's in development and will be really open by the beginning of the next school year. And in that program, we're going to be working closely with teachers, our community, and not only locally, but because online opportunities nationally and internationally, as you mentioned, to make sure that people understand about children, how they learn, how they grow, how the development looks, what red flags look like, even the subtle things. It's not always the overt things, like the child truly can't see or has a true hearing problem where the parent's calling the child's name and the child doesn't respond and everyone's on board. It's really the more subtle things that we know make a difference. The child who's lagging behind, and we can really work towards changing, like we said, the trajectory of that child's life by identifying early.
It just seems to me that children themselves are the greatest advocates for what I would call this open, free, magnificent society called the United States of America. And not because they're this very famous statement that children are our future, et cetera, which they are. But really, children need to be paid attention to in different ways. And we have the mechanisms, the knowledge to be able to help parents, no matter who they are. We need to fertilize the environment with the idea that parents are very valuable. Parents are very, very valuable. They can be much more valuable to the future of those children than anyone could ever believe. I mean, I've seen the changes in this whole scourge of utilization, and I, with all due respect to the child who is in the autism spectrum, you know, for a period of time, everybody was hiding behind, well, you know, there's a reason why my child is in the autism spectrum. Well, we understand there are a lot of reasons, and yet we've expanded our knowledge of autism. Instead of having only four levels of autism, now there are 10, 12 different levels. We modify our responsibilities. What do you think about that?
I think we're on a learning curve. I think that when we are open to discussions like this, when we invite professionals and families and parents and a number of early childhood and elementary school and high school teachers to the table, we have dialogues. And one thing that we know at Mailman Segal, that it starts very young, again, those first 3 years are critical, critically important for the future of not only our children, but our communities and our nation. So we know that children learn differently than perhaps we've been told for the past 25 years, that not passive learners that sit and are given information. We want our children to be active learners. We want to test theories and provoke them to learning. We want our teachers to be as involved in the learning process as children. And I think that it may sound simplistic, but that's quite a complicated concept that's very different. We call that constructivism, or the way our preschools run, we are a constructivist preschool. We want to look at the way children learn, because we know that if we could get to these children early, a lot of the issues we're talking about will be picked up earlier, will be handled earlier, early intervention will start earlier. So I don't think there's a one answer to this very complex conversation that's so important to have. But I couldn't agree with you more. There has to be a shift so that our youngest citizens get exactly what they deserve. And they deserve a lot. They deserve to be listened to. They deserve to be taught in a certain way. They deserve to have parents who are listened to and professionals who are trained to work with them.
Dr. Breffni, you know, this we can probably go on for another show, but we're down to the last 5 minutes. But I want to get to the question really at hand, is that I think people now, not only because of the safety issues that have been brought on us because of these massacres that occur in our school systems and other areas, obviously the shootings and Pulse and whatever, we're not talking about the politics of it, but when you look at the children and realize that we're asking those children to become the mathematicians, the scientists, the doctors, the teachers, the truck drivers, the worker at the steel mill, they are people that have to be enjoined by the parents and the teachers to understand that we do care about everything they learn.
Precisely. And, you know, we also have to recognize that we're preparing children for careers today that don't even exist right now. And so part of our job is to recognize that children are capable, they're curious, they're confident, and how do we ignite their entrepreneurial spirit? And we do that at the Mailman Segal Center, as Roni said, using a constructivist approach. We think not just about the skills and concepts that children need to learn for their school readiness, but also tapping into their disposition, their motivation, and how do we ignite that curiosity? And how do we make learning exciting for children? And within that microcosm also, how do we show children how to get along with each other? We know that tolerance starts the moment a child is born, that by the time an infant is 9 months old, they have a preference for a playmate. And so at the Mailman Segal Center, we look at that, at how we intentionally create a community of learners within our classrooms, that we accept that there are differences in how children learn, and that we accept that there are differences in how children approach learning. And it's as much also about giving children tools for how to deal with conflict, how to settle disputes, how to compromise, how to negotiate, and to appreciate different perspectives. And we do that by setting up situations where there is no right answer, and the answer to a question may not matter, but the process of having to think of creative solutions is what is important. And through that process, then children are able to see that there are varying perspectives, that novel ideas are worth pursuing. There might not be a positive end to that, but try and try again. Create those theories, work in a small group, see how what different perspectives the different children bring to it. And that's those approaches to learning are to us as valuable, if in a sense not more valuable, in today's learning environment than skills and concepts. You can teach skills and concepts at any time.
Dr. Leiderman, we're down to the last 1 minute of this show. Tell us where Mailman Segal is located here on this campus of Nova Southeastern University.
Thank you, Fred. The Mailman Segal Center is right on the campus of Nova Southeastern. Mailman Segal Center is a large facility where we have four playgrounds. We have clinics and research, as I mentioned, and early childhood programs and programs for children with a diagnosis of autism, and research, and just a wide array of programs to support learning and to support our community of learners. And we are right here on campus. We're available for a number of challenges and a lot of supportive resources for families and teachers and professionals. Anyone that works with a child, we welcome you to our center. We welcome you to join us in terms of not only our programs and clinical services, but also our academic programs and resources.
And we'll put up a telephone number, and that'll be a general number, and they'll be able to be, communicated with the proper individuals, correct?
That is absolutely correct.
Well, I wanted to say thank you to both of you. Dr. Roni Cohen Leiderman, it's nice to see a middle name in there. Welcome. And Dr. Breffni, thank you very much for being here. I appreciate it. I think that the folks out there, this might have been a little bit off of the traditional how do you cure and how do I deal with a medical problem, but I really think that the reality is that the challenge that we have as a society is to recognize the future of our children. And I think it all starts somewhere inside of what you both have been talking about. If I knew where the real answer was, I wouldn't have you on this show. But I want to thank you both. And folks, if you have any questions, you have any comments relative to what you heard, there's a telephone number and an email address right here. Please feel free to call us. Remember, this show is your show. If you have any topics you want us to discuss, just let us know. This show is called Dateline Health. We come to you from Nova Southeastern University. My name is Fred Lippman. Until next time, see ya.